Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Citizen by CNN, the first 100 days. We are joined this morning by David Chalian, John King, and Abby Phillip. And we want to do something a little bit different this morning. We're going to focus on the state of the states. What is happening in key states around the country and how that is already having a national impact. And we're talking about, first and foremost, voting rights and also COVID restrictions and political censures. So we have already a lot of great questions from you out there. And remember that if you haven't submitted a question, you still can by looking at the box on the right of your screen as we talk. But before we get to those questions, we want to kind of set the table here and set the scene and explain why this is such an important topic to go into the states, even though we are obviously a national news organization, we are national political reporters, but it matters so much. And I'm going to start with our political director to explain it. David?
Well, I'll just say, first of all, as a political reporter, one of my favorite events to cover is a National Governors Association meeting, right? Because you would go and you would get unbelievable access to all of the nation's governors that would attend in this sort of nonpartisan organization. And you could hear about all the different issues and priorities that each of these governors were facing in their states. And it is true, this is an overused expression at a meeting like an NGA meeting. They are the laboratories of democracy, right? We've seen through our history, big national policy proposals started in states, right? So let's use in the welfare reform example from the mid-1990s that Bill Clinton pushed through. That was a Wisconsin effort initially that we saw sort of developed more broadly on the national scale. Even Mitt Romney's healthcare plan in Massachusetts was a sort of feeder into a national plan that Barack Obama pushed through in his administration. It was also true back in the day that governors were more likely presidential hopefuls and winners. That hasn't been true in the last 12 years. The other reason why I sort of like to check out what's happening in these states. But it does sort of feed in. Now, I think we've seen a little bit of a reverse of that lately. I think we've seen a more sort of top-down policy agenda, and less have we seen Washington take up something that has been significantly developed in the states. But it's so important to pay attention to what's going on there because it has that ability to bubble up. Also because it can be at odds with what's happening nationally. And I'm sure we'll get into this like we see with the issue of voting rights right now, sort of states versus federal approach. One final note I would just make here about the importance of what's going on in the states. In this current political context, Dana, as you know, when Democrats control the White House, the Senate, and the House, the place where the Republican Party has majorities, if you will, are in governorships and state houses across the country. So there's a significant political difference at the moment. And then don't forget that we are in a redistricting year, and that happens at the state level. And so much of our politics bound up in these boundaries that are drawn at the state level, that also is a reason to sort of hone in and pay attention on what's going on in each of these states.
Right. National politics are guided by the way that the districts are redrawn, because we're talking about the makeup of the House. That's such a good point. Awesome, David. You know, you should consider doing this for a living. You're pretty good at explaining. Before I get to the viewer questions, and I want to start that with you, Abby. John, you feel similar, and you started your political career, as an AP political reporter, driving the country, talking to governors and mayors about this.
Right, and to David's point, I love the old National Governors Association meetings, but I was actually more of a fan of the U.S. Conference of Mayors, because then you get, you know, the mayors complain about the governors complain about, you know, Washington and Congress and the president. But that's the way it works. Look, David just went through this, and we're going to get to some of the details. But whether it's COVID restrictions, whether it's voting rights, which is a paramount challenge of our time, whether it's taxes and spending, we're going to have another Obamacare debate when the Supreme Court rules in a couple of months. California is thinking again about recalling its governor. That's what brought Arnold Schwarzenegger into national politics in the United States. So Washington is often a lagging indicator. And that's why it's critically important. And COVID has hurt political reporting to a degree. That's why I go online all the time to read all the state, local newspapers, look on social media for the great political reporters out there at the local level, whether they're covering schools, whether they're covering the governor. You see this playing out now in New York with the Cuomo controversies, whether it's the harassment allegations or the COVID, you know, in the nursing home. Local reporting. This puts a premium on great local political reporting because those of us who love this, you know, can't travel as much, can't reach out and touch as much. So it's just a dizzying time on hugely consequential issues. So even as we sit here every day and say, you know, we have a new president, that's important. We have a Democratic Congress right now and Republicans trying to find their place. It's critically important. Don't get me wrong. All of these issues. But there's so much happening in the states and often for the people watching. It's more relevant to you. It's more meaningful to your daily life, but what's happening in your community.
Okay, I want to start with voting rights and want to explain, I'm sure people who are watching this know what happened in Georgia yesterday, which is that the state Senate passed an election bill that, among many things, would repeal no excuse absentee voting. And this is, you know, kind of a prime example. Maybe it is ground zero politically for what a lot of these states that are dominated by Republicans in the legislature are trying to do. So Abby, I wanna start with you on this viewer question. I live in Atlanta and the Georgia Senate recently passed legislation eliminating election polls open on Sunday, reduced polling hours and limited early voting. The legislation also includes restricted absentee mail-in ballots, as I mentioned. With Congress passing HR 1, how can states like Georgia still pass legislation that counters federal legislation? Well, I know you'll explain that, but talk about the picture of this.
Yeah, I mean, I think the big picture is that Republicans are, this is the backlash to 2020, the backlash to a year in which there was a massive amount of voting in which people participated because they were able to in a lot of different kinds of ways. And I'll take the last part of the question first, because I think that'll set the table for where we are. You know, HR 1, which is the bill that passed the House of Representatives on, it's really a very sweeping overhaul, frankly, of voting and, you know, civics in this country. It has only passed one chamber in the House, and it still needs to get through the Senate, and it has a really, really tough path to doing that. And so for that reason, HR 1 is not in effect. And what is available to Republicans is to use their state legislatures to move forward these bills that restrict voting. And Georgia could not be a more clear example of why this is happening. You know, in 2005, the Republican legislature approved no excuse absentee voting because in the past, Republicans actually believed that absentee voting was something that their voters liked to take advantage of. People who tended to be older, people who tended to live in more rural areas might want to vote by absentee ballot. And so they were perfectly content with that, 15 years ago. But what has happened since then is that former President Trump has poisoned the well with lies. And we know that they're lies because there were, I believe 35 cases of fraud that were referred from the Secretary of State in Georgia in relation to the 2020 election. That's fewer than 50. That's like less than 100 in a massive state of Georgia. So very, very few, a few dozen cases of potential fraud referred for criminal prosecution really seems to indicate that even though there was widespread usage of absentee voting, there was no massive wave of fraud. However, Republicans also know that Democrats took advantage of absentee voting more than they would have liked. And that is why they're cracking down. At the end of the day, though, one of the reasons that all of this is happening, and I think the larger question for lawmakers is how do they fix voting? Maybe it's HR 1, but maybe it's also they need to figure out how to, in a bipartisan fashion, revitalize the Voting Rights Act, which when it was in full effect, would have created a litmus test for states like Georgia before they can pass laws that restrict voting. They would have had to get what we call pre-clearance from the Justice Department to approve those changes before they go into effect. What's happening now is that these laws may go into effect, and yeah, they may be struck down in litigation after the fact, but it may only be after people have been disenfranchised. So there's a real problem here with a gutted Voting Rights Act and Congress locked up on legislation. Unless they're able to find a path forward on either of those things, I think you're going to see more of what we're seeing in Georgia and places like Iowa and Arizona and even Florida, et cetera, happening all across the country.
Yeah, I mean, as you've said so many times, Abby, looking at 2020, if you make it easier for people to vote, they vote. They vote, they take advantage of their democratic privilege to go and vote. And the argument that we have heard, the fraudulent argument that we heard from the president, and Republicans pick up on it, is that it was, you know, filled it was rigged, and people didn't actually vote who said that they voted, which is just not true. It is not proved in any way. And so what a lot of these legislatures are doing is, you know, trying to roll that back, trying to make it harder for people to vote. There's no other way to say it. And so, David, on that, another viewer question, Republican voter suppression is rampant throughout the U.S. What are we doing to make sure all Americans are able to equally cast their vote? How can we implement the life-changing voter suppression preventatives that helped the state of Georgia find her voice? Did we even beg Stacey Abrams to help us nationwide? I think the we, I'm not sure who the we is, but you can answer the question as you would as a good journalist.
I mean, I think, well, first, let me just take that last part. I think Stacey Abrams has worked on this nationally, not just in Georgia, and has been a huge part of this renewed priority effort inside the Democratic Party to make sure that access to voting is something that must continue to be worked on legislatively, right? And that's why H.R. 1, what Abby was describing, while its fate in the Senate doesn't seem promising, it's why now for two Congresses in a row, this was Nancy Pelosi's sort of priority piece of legislation to continue to pushing for. Now, I am curious to see if indeed, and we saw Joe Biden sign an executive order this weekend, but I am curious to see if it is clear that H.R. 1, this bill, this voting rights bill, sorry to talk in Washingtonese, is dead in the Senate, doesn't have a chance, and filibuster reform doesn't happen in some way for that bill. What is Joe Biden, because I don't think he's really spelled this out yet, What does he have available to him, and what can he do, and how does he keep this on the front burner as a major priority for the nation to keep the franchise available to all who deserve to have it? I mean, and I just want to be clear here, Dana, when you were saying, obviously, there's no proof to widespread fraud in 2020, and lots of Republicans have signed on to Donald Trump's big lie, or at least allowed it to continue to fester in a way without taking it on. You know, this issue of voter fraud versus voting rights, it used to be this partisan back and forth. For a lot of my career in covering these issues, you would hear sort of the Republican take and then the Democratic take. That sort of has left. I mean, I really, when you have a Republican election expert like Ben Ginsburg, who works on this for years, come out and say in the middle of last year, like, that whole voter fraud thing just isn't there. There's just not evidence of that argument holding water. Then when you have specific to 2020, because Ginsburg was talking more broadly, Attorney General Barr, FBI Director Wray, say plainly that there was not widespread voter fraud at all. To me, this is no longer sort of, I mean, I know it's a partisan battle. I see what's happening with Republican legislators in the states, and I understand how the parties are organizing around it, but it's no longer really one of of any kind of equal weight. I mean, the idea of getting everybody who can legitimately cast a ballot to do so is something that should be celebrated and uplifted by all participants in our democracy, right? So that to me is where the Republicans are in a bind here, because as you noted, it is clear that what they're doing is legislating it to be harder to cast a ballot, and that doesn't make sense. Now I'll just add this one other thing. Our colleague Harry Enten, if you didn't see on Sunday, wrote a piece where he made the argument that it doesn't necessarily even help Republicans politically, this notion of restricting voting rights and therefore having a lower turnout election. His argument is this is more about persuasion than turnout, if you will, mm-hmm. in terms of the bind that Republicans are currently finding themselves in. That he went back and looked at elections that didn't have the kind of expansive turnout explosion that we saw in 2020, and still Republicans that weren't able to win those elections. So I don't know that we know assuredly that mm-hmm. a universe with fewer people voting is somehow always going to be beneficial to Republicans. But I do think we all can agree a universe where everyone who has a right to vote, that is readily and easily available, is a better thing for a participatory democracy.
So I'm going to go to another viewer question for you, John, but I just have to say on that very note, David, I got a text from an Ira Republican, longtime veteran Republican there, said about what they passed in Iowa. I don't know if my party thinks through that suburban voters are becoming Dems and they will vote even with restrictions. Our voters, meaning Republican voters, are increasingly less educated and less reliable. I don't know if we understand enough what impact this will have politically. So it's exactly what you were just saying. Okay, so another viewer question on this same topic. Given that this is the responsibility of the states to establish and maintain elections, and given the recent spate of restrictive rules that are being proposed to limit voting by targeted groups, does the federal government need to establish a more comprehensive set of election laws beyond H.R. 1 to protect free and fair inclusive elections in every state? How do we assure that election procedures in every state can assure that secure election to assure a secure election, to avoid another 2020 debacle?
Look, there are 1,000 layers to this. On the question of what can Washington do. If you're watching in a state, especially a state, 43 states now have legislatures at least trying to restrict voting access. 43 states is the current count. If you live in one of those states or in any state, this is first and foremost on you. I'm not trying to pass the buck here, but you cannot count on Washington to do anything. Abby and David just went through the Senate math. We don't know what Joe Biden can get through. Even if they get something like H.R. 1 through, some federal voting rights legislation, you can expect challenges in the courts, because this traditionally has been, the Constitution says, states administer their own elections. And with this Supreme Court and the conservative majority, I would leave open the possibility that even if Washington did something to set federal rules, some of those rules might get rejected in the courts. You challenge them in a conservative state in a federal court, you get a Trump appointed or a Bush appointed, or even perhaps an Obama appointed judge to say, no, that's too much power play in Washington. It makes its way to the Supreme Court. So do not count on Washington to help you here. It's a very important debate. We will watch it go through. But legislative math and potential court challenges say you should understand this is your challenge at home. Back to the other point, there's so many. Look, we should be able to have a conversation about voter security, especially after all the outside interference from Russia and other in the last election cycles. Hard to have that when the parties involved don't trust each other. We should be able to have a conversation. Yes, there's nothing wrong with a Republican or a Democrat or an independent saying, hey, the population of Georgia has changed a lot. Can we look at the voting rolls? Hey, Arizona's changed so much in the last 25 years. What are we doing about registration? In a vacuum, those are perfectly legitimate conversations. The problem is we don't live in a vacuum. We live in a climate stoked, as Abby just very importantly noted, by Trump. In the more immediate terms, this is about Trump. This is about Trump has grievances and a lot of local Republicans trying to establish themselves as the next generation of Trump Republicans. And then there's just the historical fact It's a fact. These laws have been used in the past mostly to deny Black people and now to deny Latinos the right to vote, to make it easier for them to vote. So would it be nice to get to an age where states were having conversations about maybe, you know, somebody wants, there are genuine people out there who are not vote suppressors who like to talk about voter ID. The problem for those people is they are grossly outnumbered by people who want to use ID, rolling back poll hours, rolling back mail-in ballots to keep people from voting. So we have to get to a respect and a credibility juncture first. I don't see that coming in the next few years. So if you live in a state where they're doing this, you're going to have to mobilize yourself. You're going to have, Stacey Abrams proved this in Georgia. Look what happened in Pennsylvania last time. Donald Trump got way more votes than he got in 2016. And Joe Biden still beat him, and beat him by a decent, healthy margin. What is that? That's organizing. That's activity. That's coordination. And if you live in one of these states, watch the national debates. But this one's on you, because every state is going to do this in a different way. And if you organize and protest, maybe you can change it.
Yeah, it was also early voting. It wasn't done as right. aggressively in Pennsylvania as other states, but right. you know, Democrats took advantage of that. So on the notion that you were just talking about, John, of, you know, taking it upon yourself if you want to change things in your specific state, this is a really interesting question. I'm going to put it to you, Abby. Won't these efforts to restrict voting in states like Georgia trigger major companies to avoid new investment in the state as their minority customers demand accountability? The first thing that comes to mind about Georgia for me is Hollywood. I mean, they spend a lot of money shooting in Georgia because Georgia makes it, you know, beneficial for them financially to come there because they get tax breaks. You know, if Hollywood decided like they have in the past, in North Carolina, for example, to say, we're not going to do that anymore, Georgia, would that make a difference? And other industries, other commercial enterprises?
Yeah, this is actually one of the big issues, I think, happening right now in Georgia that a lot of these activist groups are working on. It is not only Hollywood, the movie and TV business, but also companies like Coca-Cola and companies like Delta, who have their headquarters in the state. And there's a group, Black Voters Matter, who has been organizing exactly that, trying to galvanize people to put pressure on corporations, to get those corporations to put pressure on lawmakers to roll some of this stuff back. And they have precedent for that in North Carolina. I remember when there was a whole debate over the bathroom laws and transgender rights, and corporations, and I believe it was the college sports. They basically said, we are not going to do business here if you don't stop this effort. And so it can have a really significant impact if it is done in a timely fashion. I know already in Georgia that there's been a sentiment that the business community has been more tepid than the activists would like. They have not it has not been a, if you don't stop this, we will boycott. They've not been willing to do that. And so, you know, it kind of has to be a pretty full-throated effort for it to work, because it has to be the threat of pulling out that needs to be taken seriously in order for it to have an impact. But it absolutely can have an impact. And this is coming off of a year in which companies have been trying to, you know, to talk about diversity and inclusivity and you know, rights for Black Americans, especially after the protests last summer. And I do think that the public, you know, this is where consumers have to weigh in. I mean, you can either be content with the statements, or you can insist on actions from corporations as well, because they're players in this democratic system as well. So, and they put a lot of pressure on lawmakers. So I think there is still a lot of room there for you as a consumer, just like you as a voter can weigh in, you as a consumer can weigh in and say how you want, you know, these places where you do business with to behave when it comes to some of these issues, not just social issues, but you know, things like voting are at the you know, foundation of our democracy. Even this past All-Star weekend, you know, LeBron James and his group put out this big ad around voting rights in Georgia because All-Star weekend was being held in Atlanta. So people are doing that, and consumers play a role too. And it really can have an impact. And we'll see. I mean, the Georgia bill in the state Senate was approved by a margin of one vote. One vote. So that's a very narrow margin, even for a very conservative state historically like Georgia. So that seems to indicate that there is room there for influence to have to make a difference.
Okay, one more question about this, and then we're going to talk about COVID with regard to how it's what's happening in the states. So this is kind of a broad question from a viewer. My question for the team today revolves around the primary process. So often we see politicians more concerned with appeasing their more extreme base than their broader constituency. Part of that phenomenon reflects the nature of gerrymandering, David Chalian, but it isn't part of it reflective of the way primaries are conducted. Do you think that politicians would be more pragmatic and reality-based if primaries were restructured such that everyone could participate in each primaries simultaneously rather than just the most ideologically motivated voters who currently participate? Is such primary structure possible? Well, it's happening, right, David, in places, the jungle primaries in places like California?
Yeah, but I think it's a combination of the two things together, though, right? For instance, we're about to see a couple of special elections take place in Louisiana, right? They have, as you said, a jungle primary, right, where everybody sort of gets in, irrespective of party. If nobody reaches over 50%, you go on, the top two finishers go on to a runoff election. This is, as you described, Anna, what we now see statewide in California as well. But here's the thing. In a deeply red Republican, heavily Republican drawn district, I don't know that you're going to avoid, even in that scenario, the run to the right, because you're courting primary voters, yes, initially, and you may go into a runoff, but it's you're not all that concerned about sort of making this big, huge appeal if it's sort of a guaranteed Republican district. And the same thing, you know, on the Democratic side and in the other district in Louisiana that's about to have a special election. But you kind of need both. You need the independent, nonpartisan drawing of these districts. And then I think maybe a jungle primary system like the person who asked the question is mentioning could have a real impact in constantly sort of driving politicians to a place that has much broader appeal than the current primary process. But I don't think, I look at what we are seeing in California. I don't think one without right. the other actually gets to what I think the viewer is trying to get to.
That's a really good point.
There are a lot of people, the California case has helped Democrats in the sense that there's no functional Republican Party statewide in California right now. So at least two Democrats get to compete. But Republicans would argue it is also just, you know, the Republican Party was already in sharp decline there. But this has made it even worse because you don't get candidates on the ballot. You don't get candidates who can, you know, maybe run and lose once, but learn and get tested and understand to reach out to people. The other issue to me is more on a House level. This is about redistricting for state legislative races and for U.S. House races. If you have more competitive districts, those candidates have to talk to a broader pool of voters. If you draw all blue districts at the state level or for Congress or all red districts, well, then you get what we see in both parties. It's your candidate more to the left is likely to win a Democratic primary in most places and vice versa. I do think one last point. I do think that 2022 is going to be fascinating to watch because we have not only do you have, you know, history tells you Joe Biden's a Democratic president. Very narrow majority in the House, a tie in the Senate. History tells you the Democrats are in trouble. We'll see if history matters when we get to 2022. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But one of the complicating factors here is going to be the Republican primaries because of the Trump impact debate. And you'll see this in a bunch of House races, but you'll also see this in the people who voted, you know, against him on impeachment or conviction. But just think about what happened yesterday in Missouri, Roy Blunt retiring. Right. We know Pat Toomey retiring in Pennsylvania, Richard Burr retiring in North Carolina, Rob Portman retiring in Ohio. You're going to have establishment versus Trump candidates in those races. But I think in several of those races, you're going to have two or three or four, maybe at least early on, candidates trying to compete for the Trump wing of the party. And where is that going to pull them? So I just think we're heading into a fascinating primary cycle in both parties, but especially because it's the first key test of the Trump effect going forward.
Yeah, no, it's so true. Okay, can I just say these questions that we're getting from viewers are so good. I feel like I want to open it up for every time we do an interview with anybody and see if people will send us questions because they're awesome. Okay, moving to COVID, with Governors Abbott, Texas, Reeves, Mississippi, repealing their mask mandates, it will put the enforcement responsibility on mainly lower wage part-time workers at businesses that are keeping their policies in place. There's already been an incident in Texas where restaurant patrons threatened to call ICE after being asked to wear masks per the policy. Aside from the obvious danger of another spike, have the governor's policies and their political calculus here considered only a quick win with their base and ignored other potential side effects like burdening local businesses with police enforcement and diffusing the inevitable confrontations over politicized mask wearing? There's a lot there. Really good though. Yeah, Abby?
Great. It's such a great question. I mean, and that's exactly the problem. I remember at the beginning of the COVID era, you know, we were in an administration that was very reticent to even put out guidance on masks. And I think it really was a problem for businesses, large and small. The airline industry right now is breathing an enormous sigh of relief because they have wanted to be able to say to their customers, it is now a federal regulation that you must wear a mask on this airplane. That helps them because it prevents them from having to be the ones to enforce it all on their own, putting their flight attendants in danger, putting their passengers in danger. And so that is playing out now, I think, all across the country, where you have the larger industries actually feel okay. You know, some of the bigger businesses in the country, CVS, Walgreens, Walmart, they had mask mandates long before, you know, states were willing to even do it. And it's because it's good for their business. Now, for if you're a mom and pop business in Texas or a mom and pop business in Mississippi or in Florida, it becomes very problematic for you because you don't have the mechanism to enforce that. Sure, there are plenty of businesses that don't want to have a mask mandate and they don't. But for the ones who do, dealing with rowdy customers, people who can become violent and dangerous. We've seen that happen in the past. It's now on them. And no, I don't think that Governor Abbott, I don't think Governor Abbott really cares about that. But I also think that the view in Republican America, having talked to a lot of people who subscribe to this view, is that people should not be forced to wear masks, even in businesses. That is actually the viewpoint. And it's for a lot of reasons. I think some of these people believe that masks don't work. Some people believe that it's your personal choice whether to endanger yourself or not, even though masks are not necessarily about protecting yourself, they're about protecting other people. And I do think that Governor Abbott is playing to that. It's a political thing. It's not a public health thing. It's not even a business thing. Because if it were a business thing, you would make it easier for businesses to have mandates if they wanted to. But this makes it harder, and it puts the burden on the small businesses. It puts the burden on low-income workers who then are more vulnerable and are not, you know, yet at the point where they have easy access to vaccines. And this is where you can really get into trouble with reopening too soon and too fast for largely political reasons.
And let's just talk turkey here. Governor Abbott has had a whole lot of criticism because of what happened with the energy and everything shutting down and you know, all of the crises. And he's in trouble politically. And this is a move that he thinks, at least in the short term, gives him a little boost with the base. I mean, there's really no other way to put it.
And he may be facing a primary challenge in a very conservative, not just over the power issue, but remember a few months ago when Texas was at the heart, the eye of the storm, they were getting hit so hard by COVID. And Governor Abbott was actually one of the ones trying to convince his state to take the proper precautions, even in the Trump administration. Now he's trying to go back on that because it's a better political situation for him to use Joe Biden as, you know, the opposition. But he at some point was very much listening to his public health experts, or trying to, when Texas was getting slammed. And for him politically, that unfortunately might hurt him, because Republicans hated that in that state, and he might get hit for that. And he's trying to kind of take a different strategy now that there's, you know, it's easier to do it because you can say that you're pushing back against the Biden federal government here.
John, you wanted to add something?
Well, suddenly with Trump gone, the federal government to Republicans is a great foil again. You see that in the specifics of the COVID relief bill, things that the Republicans say are, you know, born of Satan in the Biden COVID relief package were in the Trump COVID relief packages, and they voted for them. So that we're seeing that, and some of it's cynical, some of it's predictable, some of it's traditional politics that, you know, the Republicans are trying to reposition themselves. But to Abby's point, you know, Governor Abbott did, to his credit, acknowledge a mistake back in July, right? He had rolled Texas restrictions back, and then he had to reimpose them when they started to go up the summer spike. And he got a lot of credit for that then. He, you know, he said, oops, made a mistake, did it too soon. The question now is, we are in this race, right? Things are better. More people are being vaccinated. You know, the treatments are good. The case count is down but plateauing. So you have this plateaued case count, and so you have a race. Can you get people vaccinated before these new variants take root and start to spread exponentially? That's what happens. We've seen this with every one of these cycles. So you start to inch up, you start to inch up, and then you get the exponential spread. And so can you exponentially expand vaccines before the variants exponentially expose cases? That's the race right now. And right now, you know, there are some who think the vaccines will win. There are some who are not so sure. And so what has Abbott done, or Governor Reeves done? They've added another factor in that. It should be a one-on-one, vaccines versus variants. That's what the CDC wants. Let's try to win the race, our vaccines versus the spread of the variants. When you take mitigation off and now you have more spread because people are not wearing their masks, you're adding another factor in, another, you know, pro-spread, if you will. Anti-mitigation, easier for the virus to grow and spread factor. And that's why the CDC is so frustrated with this. Well, the president called it Neanderthal thinking. They wanted a month or six more weeks. They understand, actually, the pressure on all these governors, the political pressure, that Americans want to get back to normal. They wanted another month or another 6 weeks. The Alabama governor tried to find the sweet spot. She gave a press conference where she was like, no more mandates. I'm tired of mandates. My mask mandate's going to end in 1 month. She didn't pull it right away. If you listen to the rhetoric, it sounds like she's anti-mask mandate, but she left it in place for another month. Yeah. Which at least gives you 4 weeks. I think the White House would prefer 6 or 8, but this is where we are. And so I do this every day, you know, and I stay up every night looking at the Johns Hopkins University data. We went up, we came down. We went up, we came down. We went way up. The question now is there going to be a fourth wave? And the winter surge started from a baseline of about 40,000 cases. We're at about 50,000 right now. So if we start to go back up again, that simple history tells you it's going to be even worse than it was in the winter. And that's why everybody says keep it down now.
Well, John, and this is to your point about the mitigation. One way to ensure there's going to be a fourth wave is if you get rid of all the mitigation efforts, right? That in that fight of the variant versus the variants versus the vaccine, if you get rid of mitigation efforts, you give the variants an upper hand in that fight. And that is why when Joe Biden addresses the nation on Thursday night this week and marks the one-year anniversary of the shutdowns, I think you're going to hear him, in addition to touting the success of getting the COVID relief bill through Congress and giving lots of praise for vaccinators getting shots in arms and all of those things. I think you're going to hear a plea for patience. I think you're going to hear from the president this need to hang in there. And I think he's talking to Governor Reeves and Governor Abbott and all those folks who are in these positions of authority to do so, to give this a bit more time, because we are not yet, because of the plateau you're describing, John, we are not yet in that place where letting our guard down will not have really detrimental effect. And so I think I am looking to hear how Biden addresses a weary nation of these life-changing restrictions. I get it, but I think he's going to try and speak to directly that on Thursday night.
All right, we're going to make a super hard turn, staying in the States, a lot less consequential, not pandemic related, but maybe a political virus that is spreading across these states, the virus known as the censure in the Republican Party. And so my question is, you know what, you can raise your hand and whoever wants to take this one. This is a viewer question. In my opinion, or just talk, in my opinion, the number of GOP censures recently has been excessive. Historically, have censures been used a lot? What situations trigger them?
This is unusual. This is, you know, it's not unique. It happens from time to time. There's grumbling. But again, this is part of the Trump effect in the Republican Party, that you vote against him. In the case that you see right now, is either you're a House member who voted to impeach, there's 10 of them, or you're one of the Republican senators who voted to convict, what, 7 of those. You have these forces in these state Republican parties who want to turn those lawmakers into piñatas. And again, it's a perfectly legitimate debate, right? Why do you view on the president? But it's the eagerness of those in the Trump camp to keep the fight up, as opposed to just let it go and maybe quietly go out and find it. You can quietly go out and find someone at primary Liz Cheney if you want, or primary Adam Kinzinger if you want, or you can enjoy the fight. And it's the enjoying the fight part that makes this so interesting going forward.
David, you want to weigh in?
Yeah. Oh, Abby. Well, I'll just say, I mean, to John's point, so much of signaling, it's about Trump trying to demonstrate that he has power, even though he doesn't technically have power anymore because he's no longer in office. And there's a bit of showmanship around this, where his allies are literally just trying to say, let me show you just how loyal our Republican parties are all across the country. These censures have absolutely no impact on anything, by and large. They don't really matter from a practical perspective. They just signal from the grassroots to Trump. We are loyal soldiers, Mr. Trump. And that's what it's intended to do. And it's intended as a warning sign to Republicans who might want to think that they can remake the Republican Party without Trump in 2022 or in 2024. I still think it's an open question. We will see whether Trump still has the actual power to win these primary races that he wants to fight, to win these House races and Senate races with his candidates, or these governor's races with his candidates. We have to wait and see on that. But the signaling is very important. It's almost the same as when I remember, in the transition when Trump was at his Trump Tower, and he would always have this parade of people coming in to see him. The visuals of paying fealty to him are extremely important. And to me, that is what this whole censure phenomenon is really all about.
Side note, the Republican Party, which is refusing to take his likeness off of their fundraisers, happens to be adding one of their nights of their meeting to Mar-a-Lago. So,
Right.
Exactly.
We know that worked really well, because right after they announced that, Trump put out a statement saying, don't give money to those other Republicans, only give money to me.
I will just say, though, guys, I think it's important to just remember that all the polling that we've seen so far out there, this divide is not an equal divide here, right? I mean, these censures are largely popular back home with Republicans. This is, as John indicated, the 10 and the 7, that's a really minuscule part of the Republican Party in Congress. And when you look at all the polling right now, the Republican Party is pretty happily majority supportive of Donald Trump and these fealty tests. So this is not, while it is indicative of an internal sorting of itself inside the party, we shouldn't mistake it for some equally divided factions that are tearing the party apart. That's not how it is. It is Donald Trump's Republican Party.
It's such
it's a smaller Republican Party, but they can't quit him.
And I'll just put in a plug for our friend Jeff Zeleny, who did an awesome piece when he went back to Adam Kinzinger's district with him. And what he looked at was exactly what you said, David, whether he's on a kamikaze mission, while he's trying to fix the Republican Party, he's, you know, potentially blowing up his own career because of, even in his own district, the Republican Party isn't necessarily with him. All right. Well, we're going to have to leave it there. It is 10:45 Eastern. Great to talk to you all.
Wow. That flew by. I didn't realize that we were.
It did. It went by really quickly. I'll call you, David, if you want to just keep talking.
Okay. Thanks.
I want to also tell you that Abby and I will be back next week to talk all things COVID. And guess who's going to be here? Dr. Sanjay Gupta. Sign up now, send in your questions,
David,
and be sure to
David,
join us.
David, we've been dumped for a brain surgeon.
You guys need to take up brain surgery as a hobby on the weekends.
Unlike David, who plays the doctor on TV, he's actually a doctor.
Okay, fine.
Sorry, David. The full package. Okay, so that's Tuesday, March 16th, 10 a.m. Eastern. See you guys later. Bye. Have a good day.
Bye.